Hello and welcome to my review of the Hyperkin Retron 5. This video is part 2, so if you missed part 1, you can click the link in the video description down below or click the annotation right here to go take you to that link. So in this video, I'm going to be talking about the user interface of the Retron 5. This is not going to be covering any gameplay per se, this is just going to be going over what the Retron 5's user interface offers. So on the main menu, you have 4 different options. You have play, game menu, settings, and power off. Power off is self-evident what that is, and play just starts the game, whatever game that you have inserted. Right now I don't have any game inserted, and game menu is game-specific settings that would pop up if you had a game inserted. So the only thing I can access by default is the settings menu. So first let's check out, let's put in a game and show you basically the other menus. So we're going to throw in the most common NES game there is. There we go. So right there you just saw how quickly it takes to dump an NES game from ROM onto the Retron 5. Now, as mentioned before, the Retron 5 is a ROM dumper. That's the way the system works. It's not a clone console in the conventional sense. This system will go and take your cartridge and read it, and dump the ROM file off of the cartridge and then run the ROM file through its internal emulators. This means that it's a sort of legalized version of, like ROM sharing and playing your own ROMs, because it does it temporarily. Once you remove the game ROM is then erased from the Retron 5. It's no longer there. So in order to play your game again, you need to go and take your cartridge, put it in again, which will redump the ROM again, and that's how the system works. As such, not all games will run on the system, especially pirate games or bootleg games or reproduction games or homebrew games that don't properly have ROM headers. But majority of games will work, and even the ones that give you problems or say like this is an unknown cartridge, most of those even still will work. So anyway, first of all is play game, so that's self-evident what that will do. So you simply press the play button, or the action button, and that will take you to the game. So here's Super Mario Brothers, but you all know about this game. It's like the most common game on the NES. Alright, so there's Mario Brothers. Then here is the internal in-game menu. You have various options here. You can return to the game, which is, just start return to the game again. You have load state and save state, as well as save state slots. You have 10 different slots from 0 to 9, so this allows you to basically save the game at any point in the game you want, so that if you screw up or you make a mistake or something, you can simply return to your state. Or if you're playing an RPG or something and you want to remember and replay a particular spot in the game over and over again, you can do that too. Video filters. These things are pretty much useless as far as I'm concerned. With them off, NES games and all your games look as they would originally, but obviously upscaled to 720p, so they look beautiful on an HDTV. But if you want, you can put on a video filter, and like here's a 2x Sal. It sort of makes the game blurry and not very good. In fact, of all the video filters that the system offers, 2XL, Super 2XL, Super Eagle, Scale 2X, IQ 2X, and HQ 2X, and none, only the last one, H2QX, or 2X, and none, are the only ones you ever want to use. This one makes the game sort of have like a soft pastel kind of look to it, which makes certain games, especially the more cartoony games like Super Mario Bros. 2 with its like animated clouds and such, this one is tolerable, but the other filters are pretty much terrible, and you never recommend using them. So, they're here, but, they're just here for, for people who want them, and I don't know who those people are. Because, here's Super Mario Bros., but it looks weird in this filter. So let's turn that off and go back. So there we go. So if I go back, it's very evident on the title screen. Here you can see the very clear pixels of the Super Mario Brothers logo. But if I go to the HQ2X, it becomes far more blurry, and, you know, Cord blends them in. So once again, there's the logo with it blended in. And that's it with it off. So that's all that does. Scan lines. If you want fake scan lines, that's what this does. It puts on basically this mesh row of fake scan lines. You know, some people like the old look of scan lines, and I'm not one of those people. I think the scan lines is a relic of a bygone era from CRT use, when, you know, CRTs would give you scan lines and you wouldn't have any choice. You know, later on, those HD TVs that are also CRTs, they don't have scan lines anymore, but, you know, this doesn't really make the games look any better or worse, in my opinion. It's just there for people who want them. Now, it should be mentioned that Hyperkin does not offer any support for, you know, intensity of the scan lines. They're either just off or on. It's not like say, the coin ops for Xbox, which has, you know, about 10 different options for scan lines, which you can turn them from very faint to, you know, very intense, or just off. But this is just on or off. Anyway, that's enough about that. Scan lines. Take screenshot. If you have an SD card inserted into your Retron 5, you can take a screenshot to the SD card and then, you know, go look at it on your computer or upload it or do whatever you want with it later. You know, put it on your Facebook or whatever. By default, on the original firmware, this was taken with a JPEG format, and it drove me nuts. Like, why would Hyperkin do that? That's so stupid. But luckily, with the latest firmware, they've changed that to support PNG as well, so now you can upload lossless screenshots, and, you know, that's really a whole lot preferable. Volume. This is your maximum volume of your game. Right now I have Super Mario Brothers muted because, you know, YouTube loves to throw up false copyright claims on Super Mario Brothers music wherever it is, so, you know, I'm not going to have that. I'm just going to have it muted. So this is, if you were super lazy or whatever, didn't want to adjust the volume with your TV remote, you can adjust the volume here. Although, I don't know what the purpose of that is. Return to game menu takes you back to the main menu, and reset would obviously reset the game. Now, game menu. These are game-specific settings. Now, these are kind of neat. The first one is game-specific settings. What you can do here is apply IPS patches to games and turn them into ROM hacks or fan translations or bug fixes. This is really, really, really cool. So you can go to navigate to where your IPS patches are. You have to manually put them on, but, you know, manually putting them on is very easy. So let's just go to ROM hacks, NES ROM hacks, Super Mario Brothers 1, and let's apply Super Mario Brothers 1 DX 2.0 done by Flame Panther. So you choose that, and then you want to choose whether the game is going to expect the ROM header. Let's say it is. Separate save for patch. It's not necessary in this case because it just doesn't have any saves. Let's go back, and it'll ask me if I want to reset. Yes. And let's replay. We'll load the patch. And in this case, it's the header is getting in the way. So what we want to do here is go back, go to games menu, game specific settings, turn this off, say yes, go play, and there we go. The game is now completely loaded, and it's got this. Now that we're running a ROM hack of Super Mario Brothers, but though this one is just a graphic ROM hack that doesn't change any of the level design, I could easily run, you know, anything from like Extra Mario Brothers to like Silhouette Mario Brothers or whatever else. You know, here is Super Mario Brothers with a new HD look to it. Oh, whoops, I screwed up. But, you know, you get the point. This is Mario Brothers, but it's got like a nice, clean, new sprite look to it. And you can do this for pretty much anything. Anything that the system supports, from the NES all the way to the Game Boy Advance. So if you have Game Boy Advance games, you know, that you want to play ROM hacks of, or if you want to play like a fan translation of a Japanese RPG, like, I don't know, Oriental Blue or something, you can do that too. And it doesn't actually affect the original game ROM, because the only thing you're doing is you're temporarily dumping the ROM to the Retron 5. And as soon as you remove the game cartridge will be its original self, because nothing on the game is being modified. And in this case, not even a battery save is being modified. Nothing is, because there is no battery save. Alright, so let's go back. Game menu. Alright, now let's check out some other settings you can do here. Now let's turn this off. Remove ROM. Okay, do that. Yep. Cheats. Now, the Retron 5 does not directly support the original Game Genie cheat devices. However, what it does support is XML files that have all of the Game Genie codes ever written for that encoded into it, and then you can read that off an SD card. So if you pick these up off of Hyperkin's official website, you can then run cheat files for pretty much every single game that's ever been made. Super Mario Bros. Sure has a lot of codes because, you know, it's because of its popularity, really. So, I don't even know what some of these are, like strangeness. So, unlike the original Game Genie, which allowed you to, you know, write in a code and then manually manipulate it and then try different things, this is just enabled or disabled. So you simply press a button and now the code is completely put in. So if you want to run this, you can run it. Let's run strangeness. I don't know what this will do. Okay. Alright, it's like corrupt the tiles. But here's just an example of like a quick cheat file. It's not very useful, but hey, it's something. Alright, now let's go back. Copy save to Retron. What this is if you have a game cartridge that has a battery backup originally to it, such as if you were playing Legend of Zelda, the original copy of Legend of Zelda, and you have a battery save and you're like, you've beaten the entire game and like you want to keep your save, you can then copy that save to the Retron 5, and that does not actually affect the original save on the cartridge itself. It just copies it. Copy save to cart just sort of does the opposite. If you have a save on the Retron 5 that you've progressed very far in and you want to go and take that game save and put it back on the cartridge again, you can do that too. Although this one is sort of a bit glitchy as of the recording of this video, the firmware 2.0 beta 6. Game Boy Advance games, especially, sometimes will corrupt the save if you try and put the save back onto the cartridge, which means that you could lose your save entirely, which sucks. So, you know, sort of keep, be careful with this option. It's not necessary, of course, but, you know, for people who want it, you know, Hyperkin will eventually figure this out, and eventually will be, you know, really desirable, because it's a really cool feature. Alright, so now let's go over to the settings menu. The settings menu has a lot of different things that you can adjust here. The image filter is what I was talking about before, from, you know, turning on those useless filters to turning on the one that sort of sometimes is useful and the one that's just none. So I would just leave it on none for most of the time. Scan lines I've already covered. Apply scan lines at main menu. Well, that's pretty evident what that is. Aspect ratio. Now, what you can do here is you can adjust the aspect ratio from original 4x3 aspect ratio to a 16x9 aspect ratio to a weird one that's called zoom. So here, for example, I'm going to run, like, just stretch. Let's run Super Mario Bros. Stretch. You can see here that would put the game in a 16x9 aspect ratio. But very evident what that does. Now let's go to, settings. Zoom. I have no idea what the purpose of this is. This like just zooms in on the inner part of the screen to make just the inner part of the screen more visible. I have no idea why you would ever want this, because it kind of looks so stupid in my opinion. Turn scan lines off, go to the main menu. Here you can put that back to its original aspect ratio again. Alright, display overscan. Overscan is something that's a relic of the CRT era, where not all CRTs would be built the same. Some TVs would have a plastic wraparound on the edge of the screen where you couldn't actually see the entire screen. Therefore, there would be this area of pixels that would be displayed on most TV sets that couldn't actually be viewed. And most of the times, game developers in the early 80s, and throughout most of the 80s, in fact, would in fact put would have a choice whether they would actually want to use the entire resolution of a system and put pixels where pixels would not normally be visible, or if choose simply to choose not to use these pixels at all. This is mostly evident in Sega Master System games, where there is a row of about 20 pixels on the far right side of the screen, or the far left side of the screen, I should say, that is not typically used by most games. Most games would simply put nothing there. So if you display overscan, that would actually display dead nothingness. But certain games, such as Alex Kidd and Miracle World, actually use those pixels. So if you display them, you actually get a slightly higher resolution than you would get without that. So that's why this option is here, on or off. Force original resolution. What this does is it puts the game in not only its 4:3 aspect ratio, but the exact pixel resolution of whatever the screen originally was. Now, most game systems would conform to a 4:3 aspect ratio, but not everything the Retron 5 supports does that. In fact, Game Boy Advance does not. Game Boy Advance uses a weird 3:2 aspect ratio instead of the 4:3 aspect ratio. The 3:2 aspect ratio is sort of somewhat equivalent to 4:3, but it's not quite the same. And as such, if you force original resolution, then you would get the Game Boy Advance games in their original resolution without making them 16:9 or 4:3. So it's kind of like this, you know, weird trade-off, and it's configurable if you want it to be at its original resolution. Screen refresh rate. Now, if you have games that are originally from North America, or if you have original games that are from Europe, then you're going to run into the differences between NTSC and PAL. The Retron 5 will emulate PAL and NTSC just fine, but with this you can force the games into always running 60Hz NTSC or 50Hz PAL, or you can have it to be match the original game, which is, you know, let the game decide what region it is. So that's actually going to be useful for people who have, like, I don't know, mostly people who are going to be wanting to play like import games from, you know, North America. I would imagine, you know, most Europeans would probably prefer to run your games in 60Hz rather than 50Hz because of the inherent problems back in the day with 50Hz display of most NTSC games. But then again, you can have it match game. Screen size, which this is basically just your size of how much of your HDTV screen it's going to take up. From, you can make it to be as least as possible to make it oversized. My TV, it's probably about here or so. Sound enhancements. Now, these are features that the Hyperkin was going on and on about, of how the Hyperkin Retron 5 is going to make your game sound better than ever before, and have these audio enhancements that make the system just, man, your retro games are just going to be so awesome. Bullshit. These things suck. For the most part, I've noticed that there's very little difference, and the difference that is there, for the most part, in a lot of games that I've tried, it actually makes the game sound worse. There's three different options. There's sound enhancement, there's bass enhancement, and there's treble enhancement. These things don't actually make the game sound any better, in my opinion. Maybe if you had like a crazy sound setup or something, but for most people, you're probably not even going to want to bother even trying these, because they're useless. So anyway, GUI sound effects. These are basically just, if you can enable sound effects every single time that you move your cursor around in the graphic user interface. Alright, let's turn that off because that's really annoying. Sound. Again, volume is your master volume of all of the emulators. And again, if you were too lazy to go and adjust the volume of your TV itself, I don't get that. Manage Retron 5 controllers. Here is where you can pair your Retron 5 wireless controllers to the system, but it already comes paired, so you don't need to do that. And since the Retron 5 has those two additional buttons, you can have that adjust to be those. You can adjust those two buttons to be emulation-specific functions, such as toggle scan lines, overscan, cycle aspect ratio, volume up, volume down, mute audio, take screenshot, pixel perfect scaling, you know, your save state, load state, fast forward, etc. You can also adjust how long it is before the Retron 5 controller will automatically turn itself off, between 2 minutes and 30 minutes. Now, this is, and you can also manually turn it off. This is kind of important because the Retron 5 wireless controller does not have an on-off switch. So if you accidentally press the Retron 5 controller, the controller could be on until you either go and turn it for 2 minutes, or it can be off just by manually overriding it and turning it off. Okay, controller to player mapping. Now, this is really cool. If you're playing multiplayer games, you can map any controller to any player, essentially. You can make, like, player one controller, say if you're playing, like, I don't know, Smash TV on NES, for instance. If you were playing Smash TV, you could play player one, say player one controller has an NES controller, but player two, you don't have another NES controller, say you have a Super Nintendo controller. Player two can use a Super Nintendo port and use any Super Nintendo controller, or they could use a Sega Genesis controller, or another NES controller, or whatever else. And this can adjust between all of the different systems, even for up to five players with the Super Nintendo. So you can adjust this to be, you know, whatever combination you want. Just by default, it's player one uses any of the three player one controllers, which are, you know, the Super Nintendo, Genesis, or NES, and player two uses any of the player two controllers, which is Super Nintendo, Genesis, and NES. Or you can make it to be whatever else you want. So, you know, that's kind of cool for multiplayer. Button mapping. Now, say if you didn't want to have the original button mapping, or say if you wanted to have, like, say, you were playing, I don't know, Game Boy games, and you wanted to use a Sega Genesis controller, you can do that, and you can adjust the profile, and you can view the mapping and see how that would work. So you can use the original Game Boy A button would be the Genesis A button. The Genesis, or the Game Boy B button would be the Genesis B button, or etc., etc. Now, if you want, you can actually adjust this to have custom profiles, which I've done here, such as, like, this is using the Retrobit Super Retro Trio controller for NES games, rather than use, like, anything else, just by default, or, you know, go to wireless, NES, Super Nintendo. So if you wanted to create a new profile, it's exactly the same way it's done with the Ouya. So you add a new profile and give it a name. So I'm just for the purpose of this, I'm going to call this one Alt. It's kind of weird to use a virtual keyboard, but whatever. And then you can assign it to be whatever button mapping you want. There's just a random example of just a random button mapping. Won't actually let me do that because I'm creating weirdness. And then you just adjust to find the one that you want. And if you want, you can then go and adjust it later by going and edit it, or you can choose to simply delete it. So anyway, that's that. Hotkey configuration. What this does is it lets you adjust your emulation functions by putting in a button or a button combo to get back to emulation functions such as the in-game menu by using an original controller, so you don't actually have to use the Retron 5 wireless controller at all. So if I wanted to, say, go back to the in-game menu when using a Sega Genesis controller, I'd simply press the X button, or I can make it to be like X plus start, or whatever else. And now, every time I want to go back to the menu, so I'm like, now I'm playing a game, like Super Mario Brothers here. Let's press back and start, and that takes me back to the main menu. Alright, that's that. Fast cartridge loading. Now, this is a feature available in Beta 6 of Firmware 2.0. It's actually removed for the 2.0 stable version. Fast cartridge loading will allow you to basically speed up the how long it takes the game, the Retron 5 to dump the ROM. And that's what that function does. Console region. Now, console region, you might want to adjust this depending on some games, because games will actually work differently with whether they're running in NTSC, PAL, or NTSC-J. For instance, NES games, for instance, will run at a slower clock speed if run in European mode, because the European modes have 1.66 MHz processor on their NES CPUs, versus the 1.79 processor used in North America and Japan. As well, Mega Drive games behave differently depending on what region they're set to. For instance, if you were playing Streets of Rage, if you have it set to USA, Streets of Rage 1 would give you Streets of Rage 1 on its title screen, and it would have its, all the game would be in English. But if you change the game to Japan, you'd instead of Streets of Rage, the game would dump, Bare Knuckle Ikari no Tekken, which is Streets of Rage's name in Japan, and the game would be in Japanese. And this is how it's the original Genesis games would be determined what region they were based upon their region settings, rather than the actual game code itself. So every game would have its original, would have multi-region built right into the game. And this was eventually dropped, but that's what that is for. So it's kind of neat that you can adjust that on the fly. But most of the time, you probably would just want to have it set to auto. Auto load last state. What this does is it resumes the game back where you were last playing it. If you choose to turn this off, then the game will restart back to its title screen. So for instance, let's try Mario Brothers again. See, back to the title screen again. Oops. Down press start. Or X press start. Sorry. Settings. Alright, now we got last few options here. Automatically import saves on first run, that's pretty evident what that does. You can choose to manually do that instead, so whether you have that on or off, it doesn't matter. Save data location. You can save data to the SD card or the internal storage. I have it saved to the SD card, so then I can take those save files and put that back in my Ouya or anywhere else I want. Screenshot file format, PNG or JPEG. I already talked about this. I don't know why the hell you would ever want JPEG, so put it on PNG. Quick info, that's basically just, you know, like how to use Retron 5. Turn that off. File manager. File manager of the Retron 5 is pretty useless. What this allows you to do is adjust your SRAM, which is like your battery save RAM, and your save states. And you can adjust those files on the SD card or the internal memory of the Retron 5, but you can't actually adjust anything else. If you put other files on the SD card, it can't actually read them. Even if they're files that the Retron 5 can read, like IPS patches, you can't delete those or manipulate those. You need to use a PC for that. So Hyperkin, you really need to work on making the file manager more robust. System information, this is self-evident what this is. This will tell you what firmware you're running, and how much of the internal storage and SD card storage you've used. Pretty self-evident stuff. Write firmware update to a request to SD. Now this is weird. This is Hyperkin's weird way of having you upgrade the firmware on the Retron 5. Rather than simply give you an update file and put it on an SD card and then run it like, you say, like the PSP or pretty much everyone else, Hyperkin has you write an update request file to the SD card, which then you need to go and take to and put into your PC and then upload to Hyperkin's website. And there, you can finally get your firmware update that you can put on your SD card and then run that through your Retron 5. If you have the update, if you have a new update on the Retron 5, the Retron 5 will simply detect that and ask you if you want to update it or not. It's very complicated, and I don't know why Hyperkin did that. It's not difficult, it's just an extra step. And I don't get why. So, and the final thing is diagnostics. Diagnostics will tell you about the information of the ROM that's been dumped to the cartridge, or dumped from the cartridge. Now, most of this is gibberish to me, even though I sort of understand a bit of NES. So, let's see, this is Mapper Zero, yeah, that makes sense. This is the original Mappers, very, very simple. This is, I think it's NROM 256. It has two banks of PRG, one bank of CARE, and the rest of it, I don't really know what it means. But the purpose of this, the diagnostics here, is so that you can basically go through the Retron 5 and, you know, if you can submit this stuff to a Retron 5 tech, if Like, you find a game that is incompatible, or if a game has problems or something, I guess the tech could, like, look through the stuff and decide, you know, hey, this is what's wrong with it, or, you know, I can't figure this out. Something like that. So, anyway, that covers basically the entire graphic user interface of the Retron 5. Now, if you guys have any questions about this, feel free to leave those in the comment section down below. Make sure you stick around, because the next video is going to be covering the Famicom portion of the Retron 5, and that's where things get really interesting, because, you know, Famicom games have a lot of expansion audio and, you know, do things that the NES portion does not. So, and, you know, I've got a fairly sizable collection of Famicom games, so I'm going to be, you know, putting this thing through the ringer by giving it a giant stress test of various games, from official games to, you know, hacks and multi-carts, and seeing what happens when I try and run various things. So until then, guys, thanks for watching, and stay tuned.